All right, we'll have a look at turning parameters. That is speed, feed, and depth of cut. These are the three basic variables that you have when you're setting up a lathe. So, it should be obvious that you're making these parts. You're trying to convert them from one shape into another to give them some kind of value. And so the faster you can do that, it would seem to make sense that that would be what you'd want to do. You'd want to just go as fast as your machining operation would allow, but there's a big trade-off, okay, and that trade-off comes from the fact that these cutting tools, these actual inserts themselves, the faster you run them, the faster that is the cutting speed is, the faster that the material is actually dragging past them, the faster they wear out. And there is a significant cost associated with wearing out these inserts. You know, the inserts themselves cost money, and if you start to wear out, you can also damage the surface finish of parts, things like that. So you have this pretty big problem here, and that is that the faster you go, the higher the cutting speed is, the more reduced your tool life is. And you can see this is a logarithmic scale here. All right, so it might be if you're running 100 meters per minute, you might be getting something like 50 minutes of cutting time out of that insert, but if you double that, you might drop down to not half, but maybe 9 or 10 minutes of cutting time. All right, so different factors are going to affect the parameters that you choose. It's important to know that generally harder materials are more difficult to cut. All right, they have a higher power requirement associated with actually removing that metal. You should also know, while we're talking about this, that sometimes people will talk about a material being hard to cut, and they're not talking about the horsepower requirement. They're saying that it's hard to get a good surface finish on that part. So certain stainless steels, very low carbon steels, and copper can be very gummy. That is, they're very ductile materials, and that's kind of makes them harder to actually machine and get a good surface finish, because you're machining by shearing these surfaces and shearing off the material. And if it's very, very ductile, it doesn't want to just fracture. It wants to just flow. And so you will hear that people talking about these metals being hard to machine or difficult to machine. So there are two different uses of that word. But if we're talking about power requirements, it's the harder metals are harder, require more power to machine. Also, things like the microstructure of the material can affect machinability. So this is talking about things like the grain size, and we even talked about this already, that a finer grain size is going to be generally a stronger steel, for instance, all things being equal. But one with a larger grain size will be more ductile and more malleable. And we've already, we just talked about the fact that the more ductile the material is, sometimes the harder it is to machine and get a good surface finish. Also, the surface condition, maybe there's oxides and things like that on the surface of the material. These can affect the parameters that you're choosing. And then, oddly enough, all of these differences can occur within the same workpiece. So you can have a workpiece that starts off with one set of properties, and even as you machine it, they can change. All right, so your machining operation can actually change the structure. We talked, maybe we haven't talked too much about it, but you can have a phenomenon called work hardening, where you actually, you're compressing the material as you are machining, and that compression, that working, that plastic deformation beneath the surface of the cut can harden the material and make it more difficult to machine. The poster child for that, I think, is probably titanium. So titanium is notorious for work hardening. All right, so other things that will affect your choice of machining parameters, the other great big one is the tooling material that you're using. So we talked really briefly when we were talking about heat treating steel. We said you could take a piece of, say, a eutectoid steel, and you can have an annealed piece of carbon steel, And you can take another piece of the same steel. Now, I'm not recommending this. It's not a great idea. But you can take another piece of the same steel, and you can heat treat it. That is, you can heat it up into the austenitizing region. You can quench it, and you can temper it. And you could make a carbon steel tool that could cut carbon steel. And, in fact, this was done back in the early part of the Industrial Revolution. You could make, we learned to make hardened steel that could cut softened steel. And then it was discovered that adding things like tungsten and molybdenum could raise up the eutectoid temperature. Remember, we saw this diagram and we said that adding elements like these, in particular tungsten and molybdenum, can raise that eutectoid temperature. And what that means is that you could now, if you cut with a steel, not just a carbon steel, but an alloy steel that had all of this tungsten in it or this molybdenum in it, that it could withstand heating. Because remember, to soften a heat-treated piece of steel, what do? You heat it up. And when you start machining with a chunk of carbon steel, it's not going to take long for that steel to heat up and to anneal itself, or to at least temper itself and then soften and no longer be a hardened steel. And so you would lose that hardness. You'd lose that property. So adding tungsten, adding molybdenum allowed the steel to maintain its hardness even up to something like 1,000 degrees F. Okay, and so these were the first tool steels. These were the first high-speed steels, okay? And they break down, the high-speed steels still break down into two separate groups. One is the T series, not W, as you might imagine, for the atomic symbol for tungsten, but they're called T and M for the molybdenum series. All right, so high-speed steels are still used today. We use them less and less for cutting operations and more for things like tapping, and you can still buy a lot of drill bits that are high-speed steel. And you can buy high-speed steel like parting blanks, I guess, really. You can still buy these things for specialized cutting operations. You can grind them and cut with these high-speed steel. I will mention this abbreviation, HSS. In this context, when we're talking about cutting tool materials, it's obvious that we're talking about high-speed steels. There are also other high-speed steels also used to refer to hollow structural shapes, like we saw that square tubing earlier. And it can also refer to high-strength steels, which are a class of sheet steels, and particularly in automotive body panels and things like that. But we're not going to talk about either of those. If I'm talking in this class about HSS, it is high-speed steel. Then there are tool steels, and like I said, these high-speed steels, these were the original sort of tool steels. Then moving forward, the great leap forward came when we started using carbides. Now, we've already seen one carbide in this class. We talked about iron carbide. But in general, what we're talking about when we're talking about carbides, by an overwhelming margin, these are tungsten carbide. Now, there are other carbides, titanium carbide, tantalum carbide, that are used. But these, in general, are a very, very carbon-rich tungsten alloy. So this forms a ceramic material that is bonded together generally with cobalt. And so this is starts off as a powder. It is compacted and then mixed with the cobalt powder, compacted and then sintered. It's heated up. This is a process called powder metallurgy. There's some pretty interesting YouTube videos on this out there if you want to look up powder metallurgy. So one of the first ways to use these carbides was to braze them onto a steel shank, basically. And this was a huge leap forward because the carbides could cut much faster and they lasted a whole lot longer. You could run much faster, be much more productive with these carbide inserts. So, like I said, the first of these were to be brazed inserts. The high-speed steel, I've got this image up here. These were actually ground into shape by offhand grinding. You'd actually grind these inserts or these tool blanks into the shape of the tool that that you wanted. So you'd put different angles on there and things like that. These carbide inserts on the brazed inserts, these could actually be sharpened, and you could regrind these and use them again. So very useful thing. And then they started putting coatings on these carbides, coatings like titanium nitride, that sort of gold color. And this really did extend the life of these carbide inserts. Titanium nitride, one example of a coating, probably the classic example, has a nice low coefficient of friction. That is, it's slippery, and the tool is able to, or the chip is able to slide past the tool very easily. And they're also even harder than the carbide, and so you have a very, very hard surface, resistant to wear on the tool. So a very popular tool today is a coated carbide insert. And I say insert, this is an insert. This is a brazed insert where it's just part of the tool is carbide. The more common method now is to use what's called an indexable insert. And they're called indexable because a lot of times you can take these out and you can rotate them from one position to another and have at least, you know, multiple cutting points on one insert. So you might spend you know, $10 or $12 on an insert, and when one side wears out, you don't have to toss it. You can just rotate it to the next insert. Some of these you can actually flip over and have, like on this diamond insert, you could have four cutting edges. Some of them are not, you're not able to flip over, but some you can. And I say $10. Some of them, when you get down here to these higher, fancier materials, these can run over $100, $150 per insert. So let's see, we said about the coated and uncoated carbides, and we said that most of the time we're talking about tungsten carbide in a cobalt binder. There are also cermets, which are ceramic materials other than tungsten carbide that are bonded together in a cobalt, generally cobalt, sometimes nickel binder. Then there are pure ceramics, which are ceramic materials other than tungsten carbide that are bonded together into with no no metallic binder. And then there are polycrystalline diamonds, and these are, you know, as you diamonds are pretty much the hardest usable material out there. One thing about diamond as a cutting tool is that it's not very compatible with ferrous metals, because as you know, you can dissolve carbon into ferrous metals when you heat them up, and diamonds are nothing but carbon, and so they don't have the longevity. But a diamond tool for cutting something like aluminum at very, very high speed is a very practical solution, even though you may pay anywhere from $50 to $150, even to $300 for a polycrystalline diamond insert. That insert, you can get a lot of machining done if you have sort of a constant, very high surface speed and not a lot of interrupted cuts and things like that. An interrupted cut is like if you were turning a bar and it had, say, a hole in it, or if you were turning a piece of hexagonal stock and it was not in contact the whole time it was rotating, it kind of impacts the tool. So I should mention that what we're seeing here is an increase, and that's an increase in hardness from carbon steel all the way down to the carbides, all the way down to polycrystalline diamond. This list has been in increasing hardness the whole time. But we've been giving up something, and the thing we've been giving up is toughness. All right, so if you have a very demanding operation with a lot of impacts, you may have to go down this list back up to a more tough material and a less hard material. But really, the big middle ground is in coated carbides. Coated tungsten carbides offer a really good balance between hardness and toughness, and that's one reason that they are so popular today. All right, so here's just an indexable insert that is held in a tool holder, and that tool holder is held in this tool block. that would then mount on the tool post of the machine. And you can see it's pretty simple to replace or to index this insert. You just loosen up this clamp, and that insert, this particular one, sits on a little post, and you rotate around and clamp it back into position. All right, these inserts are available in a variety of shapes. And there you can see on the MSC catalog, you know, a whole variety of shapes for those inserts. So why would you choose one over the other? All right, well, there's a series of trade-offs here. If you just need brute strength, then you might go with a round insert. This is the strongest shape. And as you move in this other direction, what you do is you get more versatility. So if you have some kind of detail on a turning that you need to create, you can only get this big round or this big square shape into certain sort of cavities in the cut, that is the contours. As you move in this direction, you're able to get access to more of those areas, and you can make a larger variety of shapes. So this one, you know, if you need a radius on the inside of the turn, so if you had, you know, some kind of detailed shape in here, you could only machine so much of that with a large radius on the tool or with a square tool. This is called a trigon tool, by the way. But with this diamond tool, you can machine a lot of this. Now, you can't even do all of it with this one tool. So you might come in here, you might rough with one tool, and then come in here and do some more finish work with a separate tool. And of course, then you'd have to have a parting tool to come in here and part this off. So those are some of the trade-offs. Also, you have more tendency to chatter toward this end than you do with these finer tools on the right side. And as you move over in this direction, also, you have greater power requirements. But that's because you're removing more material, so I'm not sure that's really fair. Now, if you were to go out shopping for inserts expecting there to be, you know, 5 or 10 varieties, you would be, you'd be overwhelmed, because the variety of inserts that are available is just it's all near infinite. It just goes on and on. But there is a standard. This is ANSI B212 that describes a method of defining cutting tools, these inserts, by their shape and other characteristics. Okay, so if you go out to Carbide Depot, I'll probably put a link in the slides here. Go out to Carbide Depot. They have a real nice way to sort of sort out how this code works. But the way this works is the first digit is going to be some kind of a letter, and that letter is going to correspond to a particular shape along here. This W, it turns out, is a trigon insert. So this, like I said, this is a trigon. This is what we have installed in lab, and it's just because it's a real convenient insert to use, because you can do turning and you can do facing with the same insert without changing the tool post setup. But anyway, the first character refers to the shape. And then the clearance angle, we'll talk more about this in tool design when we talk about actual cutting geometry shapes, but this is sort of the relief on the back side, how much of that is built into the insert. So you get some of these characteristics from the insert and some from the holder that's actually carrying the insert. And you can see this keeps going. There's a tolerance class, and then the type of mount that it has, whether it has a hole in it and the geometry of that hole, the insert size. Now, the size is going to be given by an inscribed circle that will fit inside here. So they'll give you the size based on the number of eighths of an inch. So in this case, 4 would mean that the inscribed circle that fit inside this insert would be 4/8 of an inch, which would be a half an inch diameter. So that's a half an inch insert. And that's what this one happens to be here. And then the thickness. And the thickness is in 16ths of an inch, so this would be 3/16 of an inch thick. Then the actual cutting point, the tip radius on there, how the edge, this is the actual cutting edge, is done, and then whether or not the tool has handedness, and the facet size if it happens to have a flat on it. All right, so let's talk about those three parameters, speed, feed, and depth of cut. You will sometimes see these abbreviated VC, FN, and AP. All right, so when you're setting up, the first thing that you have the most, you know, the one thing that has the most influence on your tool life in terms of your profitability, basically, not the tool life itself. Most the tool life actually comes from the speed. But the one thing that you have the biggest chance to optimize without affecting tool life is the depth of cut. Okay, and the reason that is because if you think about a tool that's going to wear out, let's say that these two tools we ran at an identical speed, that is a certain, you know, a number of RPM, which we'll talk about in a minute, and the same feed rate, but they had different depths of cut. If that's the only difference, you see that this tool, both of these tools are equally worn out. Neither one is going to cut and make an acceptable cut, but the one on the right would have removed a whole lot more metal, so this one would have been a lot more productive. So that's the first thing you have control over. That's one of the best ways to improve productivity and not sacrifice tool life is to increase the depth of cut. So just to be clear, the depth of cut is how far the tool extends in radially like this. Okay, so we're only talking about turning operations right now. So that is the depth of cut. And you'll take a different depth of cut when you're roughing versus when you finish. In fact, a lot of times what you'll do is you'll rough with one tool, that is go in and take heavy cuts, and then come back when you're close to the right size and worry about taking nice finishing cuts with a small depth of cut. And you'll change the other variables as well. But that's a very common thing to do, is do roughing and then come back and make a finish pass. All right, the next thing that you can change is the feed rate. And this is another thing that you want to maximize as much as you can. And it's going to depend, of course, on things like the available power of the machine, whether it has enough power to do it, and whether or not this gives you an acceptable surface finish. Because as you can see, as you move faster, when this tool advances faster into the work, as it has a higher feed rate because it moves a higher number of inches per revolution or millimeters per revolution, it will leave behind this cusp, as well as other things. So you'll also get... sometimes depending on the ductility of the material, you may get tearing and built up edge where the tool actually, or where the material actually welds to the cutting tool nose and makes sort of a rough pattern on the surface. But the feed rate is how far the tool advances for each revolution. Okay, so I should point out that the units here for the depth of cut are going to be units of length, so think inches or decimal parts of an inch, like 20 thousandths of an inch. The feed rate is going to be given in inches per revolution, so this is how far the tool advances for each revolution of the spindle. And then finally, but very important, is the cutting speed. Okay, so the cutting speed is the speed, and this is going to be given in units of length per unit time. All right, so maybe feet per minute is a very common way to talk about the cutting speed. And the way to think about this is if you were to just take this cutter, and don't think of anything as rotating, just think of taking the cutter and dragging it across a tabletop. Okay, if you were to take this cutter and just drag it across the tabletop and cut a very thin layer of the top of the table, you'll probably make someone very upset, but you'll also be thinking of the cutting speed. Okay, that's because it's measured in feet per minute. Well, if you had this piece rotating now, that's that dragging sort of speed. So it's the speed that the material itself is actually going past the cutter. Now, when you look up the cutting speed in a source to try to find a good cutting speed, you'll find that they're given, like I said, in units of inches or units of length per unit time. So like inches per minute or feet per minute. I said inches per minute earlier. I meant feet per minute. It's going to be given in feet per minute because it's such a big number. All right. So, but your lathe does not have a feet per minute setting on it, unless it's a CNC lathe, and you can do it that way with a CNC lathe. But on a manual lathe, you have to convert to the number of RPMs. Well, why don't they just coordinate these? Why doesn't the book just tell us how many RPMs to set the machine to? And that's because the cutting speed depends on two things. One is the RPMs, how fast this piece is rotating, but also on the diameter where it's doing the cutting. All right, so you can see here I've taken this and divided this thing up into the same number of units of length. So let's call these inches, okay, just for fun. But see, we have four of those in here where it's a very small diameter, but out here on the outside, we've got many times that number going around. So if this were rotating at one RPM, then we would pass four of these marks every minute if we were in here, which is a much slower feed, a much slower surface speed than if we were on the outside here and we passed all of these marks in one revolution. Okay, so it depends on the number of revolutions per minute, but also on the diameter of the workpiece. And so the books don't know what diameter workpiece you're using, so they can't tell you what RPM to set the lathe to. Okay, so what are good numbers? At least what's a good starting point? So one thing you can do is look in the machinery's handbook. It has a pretty good kind of classic suggestions for speeds and feeds. The easiest place, a lot of times, if you have it, is to look in the packaging that the insert came in. So a lot of times you'll see printed on the package something that looks like this. So I'll come back to this and say this is a great way to come up with starting numbers. Another thing, if you don't have this, is to go online and look up the manufacturer's website for the insert or whatever the cutting tool is that you're using, and they will 99% of the time have suggested speeds and feeds for that particular tool that you have. All right, and if they don't, then they will at least have suggested speeds and feeds for something very similar to the tool that you have. But really, the manufacturer's recommendations I have found to be a really good starting point. So this is one example of a manufacturer recommending speeds and feeds. And this seems a little bit cryptic at first. And indeed, some of it is pretty cryptic if you haven't been initiated. But once you get the lay of the land here, then this all makes really good sense. First of all, up here at the top, we see that that ANSI designation that we saw earlier from that B212 standard. And so this is the standard for that insert. This would allow you to go out and buy a very similar or at least a replaceable insert from any manufacturer. This is not tied to a particular manufacturer. They will all say that theirs is better because of the layers of coatings and because of the chip breaker geometry and things like that. But this allows you to go out and buy a replacement insert that fits the same general description as the one that you're using. Also, it helps you to find a matching tool holder that will work with this insert. There is, at the same time, an ISO designation, and this basically just spells out the same thing as this, but it's using metric sizes and things instead of those silly fractions of an inch. Let's see. So then there's the rest of this. Okay, we go across this layer here, this color-coded. This says PMKNSH, and this is sort of a blue color if you can't see it. It's kind of blue. This is kind of yellow, kind of orange, green, or maybe that's red. Yeah, that's red. Green, orange, and blue. So these are telling you the material class, the class of materials that this is designed to cut. And if you go on the website and look this up, you'll see this actually broken down even more into subgroups. So the P is going to stand for steel. All right, and let me flick over to another slide. There, I'll grab it from another slide, another set of slides. So this is where the funny abbreviations come from. All right, so these are they come from a German from the German words for these. Okay, but it's good enough if you'll remember this is steel. The M is most sort of stainless steels. K for cast iron, And see, that one's easy to remember because K, you know, for cast iron. Then N for non-ferrous, that one is pretty easy to know too. And then super alloys, that works pretty well. And hardened materials. So the ones that you hardly ever use are pretty easy to know. The most useful one, though, just, you know, just remember it. The P is for steel, M is for stainless, K for cast iron. All right, and then, like I said, these tend to, you know, most manufacturers will take these, break them down into subgroups, and they'll say a particular steel with a particular structure and hardness and things like that. But this is a good general purpose, you know, steel in quotation marks. These are good values for starting with. Okay. And then they give you, so we're dealing with steel. That means we look at this section right here in the middle. And then we, it's a little bit troubling because it still seems a little bit cryptic. If you remember our abbreviations, then that will help you out. But it's even easier than that. You don't have to remember the abbreviations at all. All you have to do is look at the units. And you see here, these have, the AP has units of inches. And if you want to use millimeters, they are right there. But we only had one parameter that had units of inches, and that was the depth of cut. All right, so here they're saying they recommend this particular depth of cut with this insert, and then they give a range. So this is kind of the optimal, and this is the range. And then, so this is, there's our depth of cut right there. That's what that looks like. Then there is F sub N, and that is our, well, let's see, what is it? Well, it's in inches per revolution. Again, we only had one of those three parameters that had units of inches per revolution, and that was our feed rate. Okay, so this is how far it will advance for each revolution. Again, the optimum or recommended of 0.012 or 12 inches per revolution, and the range of 6 to 20. Finally, VC, surface feet per minute. So we only had one cutting parameter with surface feet per minute, and their suggestion is 1130. All right, so if you're cutting steel, this is a good starting point for that. Now, what if you're cutting aluminum and it's not listed on this particular insert? Well, that means that insert is not recommended for aluminum. Okay, so when you're buying an insert, you're going to buy it for a particular purpose. And some of them are a little bit more general purpose than others, but it really, you'll get the best bang for your buck, the most optimized use of the insert, if you'll go out and shop for an insert for the material that you're trying to cut. So don't try to use the same insert for titanium that you're using for cast iron. All right, so I said earlier that, let me just flick back up here, that you have to know the RPM to convert the surface speed, or not the RPM, you had to know the diameter of the part to convert the surface speed to RPM. How do you do that? Well, I'm glad you asked, okay? And it's this nice equation right here, 12V over pi D. You will see sometimes people say, oh, it's 3.82 times V over D. And in fact, a lot of times people will just say, oh, just use 4 times V over D. The reason is they're taking this 12 and dividing it by pi and pulling it out of here because that means the same thing. You can take this, since this is all multiplication up here, all multiplication down here, you can take this and peel it out and just go ahead and do the multiplication over the parts that don't change, these constants in here. But I'm going to just put a line through this and say let's don't use this at all because it's not really all that hard to use this formula like this and get a nice exact answer. This was maybe easier back in calculator days, but in spreadsheet and computer days, this is a little bit nicer. All right, so let's make sure we know what's going on here. N is going to be our rotation, our spindle speed in RPM, revolutions per minute. The V is our cutting speed in feet per minute. And the D is the diameter of our workpiece in plain old inches. So when you see this on the test, don't convert it to this. Don't convert it to 4 times V over D. Go ahead and just plug it in to this exact equation. All right, one reason I like to do that is because if you'll leave it like that, then it should all make good sense in a sort of a physics kind of way. All right, and let me show you where that comes from. So the 12 is there to convert the inches. I mean the feet per minute into inches, and then we're going to compare inches to inches to get RPM. So let me just show you what's going on here. I think it's kind of fun. So at first we're starting off and we're multiplying inches per foot by feet per minute. So let's just do that. Let's just take and we'll grab this piece and we'll multiply those two together. And you can see that what we wind up with is those feet cancel out and we're left with inches per minute. Okay. So that's inches per minute. And then we'll take and divide by inches over revolution. And that's the same thing as multiplying, let me give myself a little bit more room here, by revolutions over inches. All right. And then you see the inches cancel out and we're left with revolutions per minute, which is RPMs. Okay, so I think it's helpful to kind of go in there and do that. You know, pi times d, that is the number of inches in the circumference, and you have one circumference of length for every revolution. So that's inches per revolution. All right, and that's one reason I like for you to just leave it at that. Also, it's easy, it rhymes, you know. N is 12V over pi d. So that's just nicer to, it's just nicer all around. All right, sometimes you may have a cutting speed that's working out great for you. So you might be set up on the lathe and everything is going really well and you want to be able to reproduce those results on a different diameter workpiece, you need to know what the cutting speed is. So this might look familiar to you because this is the exact same equation as the other one that we just looked at. All we did is isolate for V, okay? And so this is the other way that you might need to use that. But again, not too big a deal. All we've done is a little bit of bookkeeping, and we put V over here by itself and isolated it and solved for V. So that's what you would use if you have a cutting speed and you want to be able to reproduce it, because you'll know the diameter and you'll know the RPM, which is N. You'll know the diameter. You already know pi and you know 12. All right, so that's all you need to find out what cutting speed you're working at. Okay, so let's look at an example. And it says, set the RPM of a 1.5-inch diameter steel workpiece. All right, so steel sends us to this line right here. And it says that we want the RPMs, we want the feed rate, and we want the depth of cut. Well, let's start with the depth of cut because that one's pretty easy. All right, so we've got a 1.5-inch diameter steel. Really no math to be done. The depth of cut is given in inches. The feed rate, again, there's no math to be done. All we have to know is that the feed rate is in inches per minute. We've just pulled this line out. All right, so our depth of cut, 0.012. No, dummy. The depth of cut, 0.098. The feed rate, 0.012 inches per revolution. But now we have to find the RPM. So we're given 1130 surface feet per minute and a diameter of 1.5 inches. All right, I'm going to go ahead and just set this up in Excel. So once I've solved this problem once, I'll be able to solve it anytime it crops up. I'm not going to assign this, but it might be useful for you on your test and on your quizzes if you're taking them online to be able to have a spreadsheet handy. All right, so I'm going to come in here and just grab my equation out of the slides, because I have sort of a rule that any spreadsheet that I do needs to be able to stand on its own as a printed spreadsheet. Okay, so I think that any time that you do a spreadsheet, somebody should be able to take a printout of that spreadsheet and scrutinize it and check it and make sure that it's calculating what it says that it's going to calculate. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and put in my variables here. N is what we're solving for. I might want to go ahead and put a box around that. And I'm going to say that this is an RPM. I'll put my units out to the side. Okay. V, go ahead and put that in. I like to put make a green background on something like that and put a border around it so that somebody else coming behind me going into the spreadsheet, it's obvious where to put in the input. And I guess speaking of obvious, I should probably move my output down here to the bottom. All right. So let's see. We've got our in, and we need to input our D. All right. I'll just copy that format and put it there. The V, that's going to be given in feet per minute. And the diameter is in inches. All right. And I would rather have these. Sorry, there we go. Okay, so the person's going to enter the feet per minute. What was our feet per minute from our example? 1130. All right, so I'll go ahead and put my 1130 in there. The inches, it was an inch and a half diameter. Okay, let me show you where a lot of students will miss this. They'll mess it up, okay? What they'll say is 12V, and then they'll say divide, and then they'll say pi, and then they'll say multiply times D. Now that sounds great, but it's not, because what you're doing, you've got to do the pi times the D has got to be calculated before you do this division. So put the numerator in parentheses, then divide, and then put the denominator in parentheses. All right, so we'll just say this is equal to parentheses 12 times our D, or not our D, our V, so 12 times V, and then we'll say divide by parentheses pi, and that's how you do pi in Excel, times D. We'll click on D and close those parentheses. All right, now we don't want all of these decimal places down here, so I'm going to get rid of those, and that's our answer, okay? Let me just show you what not to do. Don't say equals 12 times V over pi times D. You see, you will get a different answer, okay? So be very careful of that, and don't make that very common mistake. Okay, last of all, but almost as important as anything else in this, is the importance of having a rigid setup. This is the one sort of always existing variable that pretty much should always be minimized. All right, so this is what the behavior that you'll get if you hold on to a rod of some kind of a fixed cross section. And this could be the tool hanging out, or it could be the workpiece hanging out of the lathe. Anything that you're clamping onto that you're gonna put some kind of a force on. Okay, let me just stop for a sec. Okay, if this is a piece of steel, and we're machining it, we're applying a force down on this cutting tool. Now, let me let you think about what sort of forces might be generated in this operation. Okay, you might think, well, maybe 50 pounds, 100 pounds. It can be the weight of a Corolla acting down on this tool. Okay, so these forces are significant. All right, so that hangout, that distance, that stick out that I'm talking about, it can be the tool stuck way out here like this, or it can be a really long workpiece hanging out of the chuck. And I don't mean a really long workpiece; I mean a workpiece of any length. All right, so you've got that bar sticking out, and you're applying a force or a weight out here at the end. So that might be better to call that P and be perpendicular force or something. But just think of a weight being applied to that. How much that bar bends, how much it deflects, is described in this equation right here. And when you're machining, think of this flexing, this deflection, as bad. And you always want to minimize this deflection when you're machining. Well, here is a formula that tells you about that. And you know everything that's going on in this formula right now, except for one thing. And that is I. So let me go ahead and talk about I real quickly. I has to do with the shape. It's the area moment of inertia. And this is the same exact shape, but we've oriented it differently. Here we're applying the force against the thin edge, and it's the thickness that's resisting the force. Here we're applying the force on the thin edge, and it's the thin edge that's resisting the force. Okay, so this is I. This is the difference that I makes. So think about like a 2x4. A 2x4 turns sideways like this. If you walk across it, it's going to sag real easily in the middle. But if you turn it like this, it's going to resist that sagging. It's the same 2x4. All you did is change I. All right. E, what the heck is E? Well, you've seen E before, okay? This is two different materials. The black here has a higher E. It has a more stiff structure. It is has a higher Young's modulus, all right, or modulus of elasticity. And W is just the force acting out here, and L is just simply the length. All right, so look at this equation and think about things you can do to have a more rigid setup. Should you set up like this or like this? Obviously, you should set up like this. Now, do you have a choice between these two? Sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. Some tools are made out of, the whole structure of the tool is made out of solid tungsten carbide, which is actually much stiffer than steel. So you can have a higher stiffness. You can get more E that way. The W will come from things like the material that you're turning and the amount of cut that you're taking. But look what's overwhelmingly the most important thing here is how far that part, whether it's the tool or whether it is the workpiece, how much it's sticking out from the place that it's being held makes a huge difference. Okay, so as this length increases, the amount of deflection or bad motion that we get increases to the third power, not the second power. It increases to the third power. So you will probably hear me say over and over again in lab, make that setup more rigid. Shorten anything that's hanging out, okay, whether it's a tool or a workpiece. Whether you've clamped something in a vise, whatever it is, you always want to get rid of this deflection, because deflection, when you're machining, results in chatter, it results in terrible surface finish, it results in broken tools, it is one of the most important things in a setup is rigidity, okay? It's kind of the overarching one, and at some point, I might actually move this slide to the beginning, but anyway, here it is at the end. Know that rigidity of a setup, that is shortening the stick out, is hugely important, really, in any machining operation.